فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. All praise is indeed due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, companions. May Allah bless them all. May Allah bless every one of you. And may Allah bless our offspring to come up to the end. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all paradise. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, something very important to know is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy dictated that He send to us messengers. Imagine if we did not know the purpose on earth. If we did not know our purpose on earth, the reason we were created, and if no one explained to us, if Allah did not have messengers to tell us why we were created, imagine what would have happened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through His mercy decided and dictated that from the beginning He would send instruction. You and I know that the first of all the human species was Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And thereafter, Eve or Hawa, may peace be on her. Right at that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already knew, it was decreed, destined, what was going to happen. So Shaytan came, and what he did was, according to the narrations, from outside of Jannah, he was beaming the waswasa, the whispers, through to Adam alayhi salam and his wife Hawa. Why do I say from outside of Jannah? Because when he refused to prostrate to Adam alayhi salam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala removed him from Jannah, right? Allah says that I have removed you and you will not enter again here, which means the Jannah. So if Allah makes mention of this, then surely Iblis or Satan, the devil, was not in Jannah. So there are several explanations, but the one I prefer is, from outside he was beaming. Today it's easily understood. We have Wi-Fi, we have the internet. You know, you actually turn on your phones now, you can catch. What can you catch? The signal of someone who's outside from their mobile phone if the hotspot is on, right? Shaytan has his hotspot, I promise you. And we catch his signal all the time. And the problem is, there is no password. So you can imagine what happens to us. He keeps on coming and he keeps on telling us things and he keeps on interrupting our devices. And I'm sure you know that when there is a device, you don't just connect onto it, it could be virus. If you come to my house, you know, my daughter is seated here, she'll probably laugh at this. You come to my house, the Wi-Fi is named virus, V-I-R-U-S. That's my Wi-Fi. Why did I do it? Because when you see the network from my home, you're not going to log on to there, no way. It's called virus, right? So people laugh, they say, why is this? But it's common sense for me to say, if I don't want anyone to just come and, you know, enjoy a free ride, give it a name. So what happens a lot of the times when you log on to someone else's Wi-Fi, it could be a virus. They could be wanting to download information, or they could be contaminating your phone with something that is going to slow it down, or a bug. That's what Shaytan does, and that's what he did from the very beginning. This is why I say, from outside of Jannah, he actually beamed all this waswasa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَوَسْوَسَ لَهُمَا الشَّيْطَانُ لِيُبْدِيَ لَهُمَا مَا بُورِيَ عَنْهُمَا مِنْ سَوْآتِهِمَا وَقَالَ مَا نَهَاكُمَا رَبُّكُمَا عَنْ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ إِلَّا أَنْ تَكُونَا مَلَكَيْنِ أَوْ تَكُونَا مِنَ الْخَالِدِينَ. Allah says, Shaytan whispered, his whispers to Adam and Eve, may peace be upon them. And he said the following to them. What did he say to them? Through those whispers. He said, you have not been prohibited from eating from this tree except for the following reasons. And he gave them two reasons. He says, you could have become angels or you could live forever. You could live forever. And according to some other verses, you could live forever. هَلْ أَدُلُّكَ عَلَى شَجَرَةِ الْخُلْدِ وَمُلْكٍ لَا يَبْلَى. Two things. Shaytan says, can I show you a tree if you eat from it? Listen to this. If you eat from it, guess what will happen? You will live forever. Now, many of us here, we'd like to live a long, healthy life. You know, when you give someone a dua, may Allah give you a long and healthy life. You mean it, but you must hear the ameen. May Allah give you all long and healthy lives. That was loud enough to prove my point, okay? So, what happens, Shaytan actually said to Adam alayhi salam through the whispers and to Eve or Hawa alayhi salatu was salam that if you eat from this tree, you're going to live forever. Wow. That's something. Secondly, you eat from this tree, you will have ownership of that which will never deplete. That which will never deplete. Now, we're worried about sustenance. What's the point of me living to 150 years, 65 years down the line, I'm retired and I'm made redundant. And after that, I live on a thin pension that does not actually meet my needs. But if someone says, no, 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 we give you $1 million a day forever and ever, oh, you would want to live for centuries. Agree? That's what Shaytan did. He says, you'll have kingdom that will not, or ownership that will not deplete, and you will live forever. Now these are called glad tidings, but from the wrong source. These are glad tidings. I mean, someone's telling you, would you like money? Yeah, that's good news, man. Would you like to live long? You know your back problem? We have a back problem, right? And we suffer so badly. Shaytan is saying, you want everything to be sorted out? Yeah, don't worry. We get it sorted. Go and eat from the street. Listen carefully, my brothers and sisters. I've chosen to start this way for a very, very strong reason. Shaytan is saying, I'm offering you good health, or I'm offering you this, I'm offering you a long life, I'm offering you lots of wealth, but you have to eat from this tree. But that's the same tree that Allah Almighty prohibited you from. Right? Allah says, don't do that. Shaytan says, no, 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 do it. Today, in our lives, there are glad tidings that the devils give us. We run for them. And we are not bothered whether or not they are in accordance with the law of Allah. Whether they break that law or not. We are sick, we are ill. I promise you, every one of us. Okay, let me do my little survey here. How many of you, and put your hands up very high, have never been sick in your life? Not even a cough. Put up your hand. Not one. Agree? Not one. Besides the baby at the back, who doesn't know what I was talking about. Okay? Subhanallah. May Allah give us all good health. Say Ameen. Why? Why have we all faced sickness? Because that's part of your test. It's part of your test. It's like me asking you, how many of you have never ever solved a matter 1 plus 1 in your life? You started with it from grade 1. That's the one of the first things they taught you, right? You have to have gone through it. It's part of your test. The same applies when I have a sickness. It's a basic test. Allah is testing you. And He will keep you sick and ill sometimes for a long, long time as part of your test. You pass it or you fail it. That's the test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah promises you and Allah gives you glad tidings that if you understand my test, if you go through it with patience, if you endure, then وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Allah says, give glad tidings to those who bear patience, to those who persevere, to those who practice restraint. Give glad tidings to those who are charged up when it comes to doing good and who stay away from bad. All that is part of sabr. Allah says, give good news to those who bear sabr. And Allah gives an example of it by saying, those whom, when calamity befalls them, they say, indeed we belong to Allah and unto Allah is our return. Right? But unfortunately, sometimes when we are not well for a prolonged time, we tend to want to believe that someone did something to us. That's the first way shaitan destroys your life. Why? You were sick for 2 years, for 5 years. Because the doctors didn't know that it was just a rebalancing of your hips, your spine perhaps, or you needed a podiatrist perhaps to check your feet and to give you a little sole to put into your shoes so that you could walk a little bit better, and every sickness you had would have gone, including your migraines. But no one picked it up for 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, and you kept believing that it was your sister-in-law. You kept believing that. You know, my husband's brother has a wife. Okay, what about that wife? She is totally and absolutely innocent. Maybe you don't get along with her. Maybe, perhaps. But don't accuse people, don't blame them. Because you see, that initial trap of shaitan, we get back to it. Shaitan promises you everything if you go through the wrong door. That's why you can become wealthy, either by stealing or by working hard. If you steal, you can also be rich overnight, but you will suffer the consequences of it. And if you work hard, it's going to take you years to build your empire and to afford a few things, but it will come with lots of barakah and goodness. It keeps you occupied. And you're a happy man. You can sleep at night without worrying who's watching. When you've stolen, any knock or any sound that you hear or a siren or a blue light already depresses you and sends you, you know, somewhere else. Because you think to yourself, maybe they're here to catch me, because you know what you did. So shaitan also, there are two ways of being cured. One is through the glad tidings when Allah says, Bashir is-sabirin, give glad tidings to those who are patient. To those who endure, give glad tidings. Of what? Glad tidings of the pleasure of Allah upon them. Allah will be pleased with them. Subhanallah. So the good news is for those who endure. And this is why the messengers of Allah were the ones who endured the most. They endured the most. Nobody can say they've endured more than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because Allah loved him the most. That's why I said, Allah says, when you've endured, I love you more. We're not ready to endure. Look at Ayyub alayhi salam. What was the good news he had? He had good health, he had children, he had wealth. Allah took away his children, his health and his wealth. And he was ashamed to ask Allah to grant him the cure and to bring back what was taken from him. Subhanallah. Because he was saying to himself, I have enjoyed the bliss that Allah has bestowed upon me for so many years. My sickness is not even 10% of the duration of the gifts that I had. How can I start calling to Allah? I'd rather endure. Notice the words that were used by the messengers. When they called out to Allah, not all of them asked Allah, pinpointing what they wanted. Look at Ayyub alayhi salam, the Prophet Job, may peace be upon him. Do you know what he said? Did he say, oh Allah, give me back this and give me back that? No. At a certain stage, he only told Allah, because Allah knows better than you and I what you and I are going through, right? The sickness you have, Allah knows better than you what it is. Sometimes we don't even know, wrong diagnosis. So Ayyub alayhi salam says, وَأَيُّوبَ إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الضُّرُّ وَأَنْتَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. That's it. Oh Allah, evil has afflicted me. And you are the most merciful of those who have mercy. That's it. He didn't say, oh Allah, I lost my health. Oh Allah, I lost my kids. Oh Allah, I lost my wealth. Oh Allah, everything is gone. I want you to restore it. He didn't say anything of that nature. He said, oh Allah, you know what I'm going through. You know it. And you are merciful. That's the conviction that they had. What does Allah say? This man called out to Allah saying, oh Allah, I know you are merciful. I know you are kind. I know you are the most merciful of the merciful. I am convinced the conviction is on the highest possible level. His wife told him, according to Ibn Kathir, rahmatullahi alayhi in Qasas al-Anbiya, his wife tells him, why don't you call out to Allah? You're a prophet of Allah. He says, no. How many years was I healthy for? X amount. How many years did I lose my health for? Y. The disparity between X and Y, the X is far longer than the Y. I cannot do this. I have to thank Allah by now enduring. Which means, if you've had days where you've made a profit, there will be days when you've made a loss. If you've had years where you made a profit, there will be months where you will make a loss. But the disparity, look at it. For years you enjoyed, for months you didn't. We're healthy. Alhamdulillah, the bulk of us are generally healthy. We're all sitting here. We have reasonable health. Small matters. So we've been healthy for the last 30 years. Allah says, for 1 or 2 years, we're going to test you. Out of how many? Out of 30 years. 2 years you've been in the bed. May Allah not do that to us. And may Allah grant cure to those who have any sickness and illness. Amen. But the example I'm giving you is, we become so despondent. There is good news in the Quran, in the stories of the messengers, because when we go to them, we will learn what they did and we are reassured regarding the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ فَكَشَفْنَا مَا بِهِ مِنْ ضُرٍّ وَآتَيْنَاهُ أَهْلَهُ وَمِثْلَهُمْ مَعَهُمْ رَحْمَةً مِنَّا. Allahu Akbar. Allah says, as a result of that dua of the Prophet Ayyub alayhi salam, he just said, you are the most merciful of those who have mercy. Allah says, we responded. What did we do? We removed every evil that he was going through. And we gave him double what was taken away from him. So do you know what happened to him? He had so much, then it was all taken away. He was patient for a long time. When it came back to him, it came back double what he had before he lost it. This is why I always say to people, the proof is in the Quran. The glad tidings in the Quran. If your factory burnt down totally, your business suffered a loss right to the ground, wallahi, if you are patient and you endure in a proper way for the sake of Allah, what Allah will replace for you will definitely be way beyond what He took from you. The same applies in your marriage. If you've been through a divorce or you have been widowed some way or another, if you endure, if you do not become despondent and depressed and you are convinced that Allah has a better plan, that divorce or that difficulty will lead you to a relationship that was way better than what you lost. But you need the patience, you need the time. You need not to say to Allah that, oh Allah, when is this coming? When is it coming? I've been calling out to you for 40 days. What's 40 days? Subhanallah. I remember one of the youngsters, I think I might have said this the last time here, when I told him, if you read your salah on time, Allah will respond to your call. He came back to me 3 days later. He says, he hasn't yet responded. I've been reading salah for 3 days. I said, what are you talking about? You make a dedicated, you know, you dedicate yourself, you make a promise, and you follow that through with the conviction within you that you are going to carry on even beyond that is responded. Why Allah sometimes doesn't give us? Because we become holy for as long as we have the problem. So we say, oh Allah, I'm calling out to you, grant me health. As soon as the health is restored, the Quran says that human nature makes you go back into your sin. Because why? I'm no longer sick. So now I go back. So Allah says, we'd rather keep you the way you are so that you are close to us. That's Allah's plan. Subhanallah. You see how Allah says we love those who bear sabr? Subhanallah. So Ayyub alayhi salam was granted that. There is another beautiful example. Powerful, powerful example. The example of the Prophet Yunus alayhi salam. And we're talking about glad tidings regarding the prophets, okay? So how I've decided to tackle the topic is to make it as relevant as possible to our lives, okay? We all go through problems and issues. What are the glad tidings that come out of this? The messengers definitely gave glad tidings of Jannah. I spoke about that slightly yesterday. The messengers definitely gave glad tidings about what will happen to those who worship Allah, the goodness in this world and the next. I discussed that yesterday when I was speaking about the Quran. So today, I want to talk to you about glad tidings inside difficulty. What we learned through the messengers, the glad tidings that came. Yunus alayhi salam, he was the beloved of Allah. At his time, he was the best, the top. At his time, he was the Nabi. Without a doubt. What happened to him? One day he got upset because his people were not listening. And he decided, I'm going. So as he's going, he realized, you know what? Hey, I think this was the wrong thing to do here, you know? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala caused certain things to happen. One of the things that happened was, he jumped into a ship, okay? And this is according to Ibn Kathir rahmatullahi alayhi in Qasas al-Anbiya, again in the stories of the prophets, that he makes mention of this. And part of it is in the Quran, but the details is mentioned in this book. So, as he's going and he jumped onto the ship began to sink, and they decided, you know, we've got to get rid of a few people, they have to jump. So one of the things, they drew lots and they asked him, he was one of those who had to jump. The people said, no, he's a pious man. Let's try and draw lots again. You know, it's unfair. It's like how some people, they don't know how to name their children, right? So they're arguing, husband and wife arguing regarding four names. Whether you keep the name, Hanan, Razan, Bassam, or Fauzan. My own kids' names, okay? So now there's an argument. Which one is it? So the dad says this, the mom says that, someone else says this, someone else says that. And guess what? Then we decide we put it into the hat. Put in the hat, we pick up one that dad doesn't like. Dad says, no, that's not fair, try again. Did you hear that? That's what the dads do, you know? Then you pick up another one, still he didn't like, he says, no, that's not fair, try again. When he sees, he says, yeah, that's the one, that's it. What happened? He goes around bragging that, you know, we picked the name from a lot because we were all like sort of arguing about, yes, dad, we know what happened. Anyway, going back to the story, so when they pick Yunus alayhi salam, genuinely, the people said, no, he's a pious man. Rather than losing him, we'd rather actually pick someone else. So they decided to pick again. His name came in again. They decided to pick a third time. His name came in and he had to go. But Allah had a better plan for him. When he went in, he was swallowed by a big fish. You know, there's an argument. Was it a whale? Was it not a whale? Whatever it was a big fish. It's called a hoot, okay? Fine. They say, no, the whale's mouth don't open so much and it can't swallow and it can. I don't want to get into that argument because I wasn't there at the time. But what I do know is it's called al-hoot. Hoot in the Arabic language means a massive fish, okay? A big fish. So he was swallowed. And the Quran says, فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ Allahu Akbar. Do you know what that means? Had he not been from among those who constantly praised us, he would have remained there forever. That means because every day in his life, from earlier on, he used to praise Allah with a beautiful voice. He used to praise Allah with a beautiful voice. And the angels used to carry this every day to the heavens. So one day, they heard the same sound, but coming from a different place. Where was it? Every day the sound used to come from one place. That day it was in the water, in the ocean, further right down in the darkness and in the belly of the so-called whale, okay, the big fish, right? So they say, oh Allah, there's a voice of the servant of yours. It's the same thing, but from a different place. So Allah says, فَلَوْلَا أَنَّهُ كَانَ مِنَ الْمُسَبِّحِينَ لَلَبِثَ فِي بَطْنِهِ إِلَى يَوْمِ يُبْعَثُونَ Had he not been from among those who praised Allah constantly, he would have remained in the belly of that fish up to the day of resurrection. But because he used to praise Allah, it helped him. This goes to show with us, my brothers and sisters, don't wait for calamity to strike before you turn to Allah, before you praise Allah. Say right now, Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. What does it cost you to move your lips? What does it cost you? Nothing. And the hadith says, keep your lips moistened with the remembrance of Allah. Remember Allah, Allah will remember you. فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ It's a verse of the Quran. Remember me, I'll remember you. The problem with us, we forget Allah. We only remember material items of the world. But that's your test. It costs you nothing to say Subhanallah. While you're sitting here, right now, Alhamdulillah, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. You can repeat Subhanallah as many times as you want. And you can even go beyond. So Allah Subhanahu wa ta'ala says he would have remained there. But because he remembered Allah, he came out. Now I can explain something beautiful. When you are close to Allah, during times of ease, he promises you that during times of difficulty, this is the good news. During times of difficulty, he will come to you. He did not say, remember me and you won't have any difficulty. No, he didn't say that. Remember me during days of ease. The hadith says, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة. Get close to Allah. Get acquainted with Allah during times of ease. And Allah will get acquainted with you during your days of hardship, difficulty. Allah will be with you. So Allah didn't say he's not going to give you the hardship, but Allah said he will help you through that hardship. He will make you content. He'll make you realize, Subhanallah. He'll make you a happy person. Now let's go to the dua of Yunus alayhi salam. What was the dua? I enjoy this, wallahi, because it's something so motivating for myself. He is now in the belly of this big fish. What would you say? Oh Allah, get me out of this fish. Agree? If I was alive in there, you know, I would say, oh Allah, take me out of this. Oh Allah, help me out of this fish. Get me to the top. My children, look after them while I'm not there. And help me to get back to them. Help me to see my babies again. So on. You know, that's the dua we would probably make. Allah knows best. But he decided, no. Level of conviction is very high. Very, very high. I know Allah. What does he say? La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu minal zalimin. There is none worthy of worship besides you, O Allah. Indeed, all praise is due to you. I am the one who has done something wrong here. I've oppressed myself. He stopped there. What did he ask? Nothing. He's just admitting something and declaring praise. He says, there is none worthy of worship besides you, O Allah. And what I did was wrong. I wronged myself. So he realized that perhaps where I am right now is because of something I may have done. Let me make peace with Allah so that once I make peace with Allah, he will do the rest. He will do the rest. And this is why we say when something bad happens to you in your life, the good news is the doors of forgiveness are so wide open, it only needs you to think of what you've done and seek forgiveness. The best way of getting sustenance is to seek forgiveness for sins. Now, there is a fine line between seeking forgiveness to earn sustenance and seeking forgiveness to earn forgiveness that will then bring about the pleasure of Allah, that will then make you a person who has great sustenance from the owner of sustenance. There is a line between it. So some people say, and I know we word it sometimes this way, that if you want to be wealthy, if you want to be healthy, say astaghfirullah. What is meant is not that you're sitting at your shop and you're saying astaghfirullah, 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 expecting people to come in and buy. That astaghfirullah should be, oh Allah, forgive me, which means, oh Allah, I'm wrong. Whatever bad I've done, forgive me for that which I know, that which I don't know. As a result, if you do forgive me, you own sustenance. You're the owner of it. You will give me, right? Subhanallah. You want to get married? Well, there's a way out. Become friends with Allah. Why? He's the owner of the hearts. Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub. Wow. Oh Allah, you turn the hearts. Turn our hearts towards the straight path. So it doesn't mean, you know, you see a decent spouse, you know, prospective. Astaghfirullah, 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 astaghfirullah. That's not the idea. The idea is, I'm seeking the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala so that I, myself and Allah, we have now a beautiful relationship. So He will just open the doors for me one after the other. You know, when you have a very good relationship with someone, do you think they will make life difficult for you? When you want something, you say, that's mine. Okay, give it to him. He's a friend of mine. Right? Allah has a higher example. I can see some of the young boys with their lips, mashallah. Well, it's working, alhamdulillah. You better mean it, inshallah. You better mean it. You seek forgiveness of Allah, you develop a relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the doors start opening. That's good news. Where did we get it from? Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Yunus alayhi salam says, oh Allah, there is none worthy of worship besides you. I've wronged myself. You know what Allah says? The man didn't ask anything. Did he ask something? He didn't say a word. He just praised Allah. He says, I'm wrong. Allah says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ وَنَجَّيْنَاهُ مِنَ الْغَمِّ وَكَذَلِكَ نُنْجِي الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. We responded to him and we removed him from that which was distressing him, from that which was depressing him, al-gham, that which was worrying him. We removed him from that. And that is how we remove the believers from what distresses them. That's what Allah says. You have a problem? La ilaha illa anta subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. Don't just say it. Mean it. Learn its meaning. This is why when people have issues, I always tell them, read Surah Al-Duha and Surah Al-Sharh. وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. That's the one surah. And أَلَمْ نَشْرَحْ لَكَ صَدْرَكْ. That's the next surah. Read it, but with its meaning. Read it with its meaning. You need to know what it means. When you read it with its meaning, your problem becomes easy because you realize what Allah is telling His own messenger, who was the most beloved to Him. What good news is this? It's very good news. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went through hardship and difficulty so that we could learn from that example of these messengers, the greatest of creation. What did they do and what happened as a result of what they did? One was the difficulty. The second thing is what they did as a result of the difficulty. And the third thing is what happened to them as a result of what they did as a result of the difficulty. I hope I haven't confused you. Right? There we are. Read these surahs, but with their meaning. So when you say, La ilaha illa anta, subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin, what was the good news? Allah says, we removed him from what was depressing him or stressing him, or let's use a word, what was worrying him. Gham. You know, gham is when you're worried. I give you another piece of good news. Many of us, a growing number of us, do not have children, even though we've been married for a long time. Am I right? May Allah bless you with offspring. But there is good news, glad tidings for you. What's the glad tidings? That is your Jannah. You just have to surrender to the decree of Allah. Allah chose you sometimes for a different purpose, and sometimes Allah will give you the child after you've cried to Him for 10 years. What happened? You gained 10 years of closeness to Allah. You appreciate His gift. I know someone who had a child after 18 years of marriage. How much? And after that, they had 3 kids against all odds. Obviously, at that age and that stage, in your late 30s, early 40s, it becomes very difficult to have children. But they were more than excited. And I recall the tears that these people have been through. How much they called out to Allah. It was easy for them to start going to all these people who pretend to know the future. And they start saying, someone's did magic on you. That's why you can't have kids. Who's it? It's someone from your own family. Wallahi, that's shaitan. That's the devil. The jinn. And I have to say this, and I may have said it before, but it's good to repeat it, because this is how we fall into that first trap that I started with. The jinn communicate with some man. It's true. The jinn do communicate. What do? They lie. That's their job. They lie. So sometimes you get a religious person, a pious person, you go to him and he reads, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ and the surahs, and this person goes into a semi-trance because there's exorcism that's taking place and the jinn begins to speak and the speech is in the voice of a male, although it's a female we're dealing with. And yes, you now know this is a jinn speaking. And what does this guy do? He's a religious person. They call them amils. They call them sometimes, you know, different names. In one place, they call them a bapu as well. I wonder what that meant. But anyway, he asks a question to the jinn. Who sent you? Who sent you? That's the best question you could ever ask a jinn, to break your whole family into pieces while the jinn is leaving. They're waiting for that question. And in every extended family, there has to be politics, otherwise you're not normal. There has to be politics. You name me one family where there's no politics, extended family. You know, brothers might get along, bring the wives in the picture and the children in the picture. You have to have a very, 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 I said it thrice. You have to have a very, very, very big heart to be able to really get along. If you don't have that selflessness, trust me, there's going to be mega politics. If you think the recent elections were bad, the campaigning that happens in some of our houses, worse than the rigging of elections, promise you. And who is responsible? The devil. The shaitan gets a prize when he has broken a home. He gets a prize. So while he's coming out in this male voice from the female, he's talking, who did it? He'll give you a name. They'll tell you, tonight I'll show you in the dream. Who has? Wallahi, these are facts, right? I'll show you in the dream. And in the night, shaitan is showing you in the dream an innocent person. And they know that you have had politics with this person. And wallahi, because a man with a beard told you who it was, or because you saw the face in the wall, that also happens. They say, look up to the wall, you'll see a face. You look up and you can see the face. All done by the jinn. What happens? You lose your jannah. These are not glad tidings, it's the worst. Maybe the jinn left you, but while leaving you, destroyed your whole life and your family. Innocent people were accused of things they didn't ever do. Remember this. So you didn't get along with your mother in love. What's the deal? Very few people do get along anyway. Those are the exception. The rest of us, we just say, I love you. That's it. That's the best statement we could probably say. That's it. It's not easy to get along with people of a previous generation, let alone someone who's trying to control what you're supposed to be doing in life. And that's a problem in our lives today. The word control is a disease more than anything else. Remember that. Oh, you who are parents, I want to just remind you, when your children get married, let them live their lives. Don't decide everything for them. Don't control their lives, because that will break that marriage. If you are itching to control their lives, let them live totally separately from you. I'd rather my children live in another continent filled with love for me than for them to be in the same home and there's hatred in the house. The love of a home is not shown by living together. Never. That is the thinking of the previous generations. People say, I live here, all my sons are here, and all their wives are here. In my mind, I say, there must be qiyamah every day in your home. I promise you. And this old man is so proud to say, we all live together. My sons in the same house, their daughters, my grandchildren, and now three of my grandchildren are married, and my great-grandchildren will be coming soon. And I can guarantee you, if I had a moment with the daughters-in-law and the sons-in-law and the others, they would probably be cursing everybody, because you cannot. You need your space. You got 20 queens in one domain. Come on, who's the boss here? And each one has their own entitlement. When the girls get married, when the boys get married, they want to start their life. That's what it is. They don't want to live a life where the dictator is someone else. No. That had already happened for 20 years. Now let them live their lives. They will make mistakes. They will. Many of us, when we were 20, we already lived separately a long time back. And what did we do? People who travel from country to country. I know my father, when he was in his early 20s, he shifted to a country known as Rhodesia. Right? We were born there. I was born there. Subhanallah. How old was he? 20 something. I think 22 maybe. At 22, he was making every decision for himself. I'm double that age. Well, just about, okay? And I tell you, it would be unfair for him to decide everything about my life. Unfair. Totally unfair. Absolutely unfair. Are you understanding what I'm saying? So, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make things easy. Shaytan comes and shaytan makes us believe that the other person is guilty when the other person is not guilty. This is the jinn. And this is where I had actually diverted the story to tell you about how you will be destroyed if you choose a path that is not the prophetic way. The way of the messengers. When they struggled, they did not choose the wrong path. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very clear. Even someone did something to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Really. In terms of magic. They tried to affect him. There was a certain effect. It lasted for 30 days. Then Jibreel alayhi salam came down with revelation informing him of who it was and where it was and what it was. Who came down? Jibreel alayhi salam. With what? With revelation. That's when he knew. If it wasn't for that, how can we claim that we know when Jibreel alayhi salam did not come to us? We are hearing it from the same devil. And I have tried this. You say to the jinn, you are lying. The jinn changes the name. It's also another person we've had politics with. You try again, you're lying. The third name comes about. And then you can tell the people, look, all these names are just false. Don't ever worry about who did it. Worry about being cured. Did you hear that? And I want to call on those who are accusing their family members of having done magic on them. Trust me, 99% of the time, they are innocent. Did you hear what I said? Wallahi, it might be bitter to digest because you've been believing it for the last 20 years. They were innocent, always. It was shaitan that broke the relationship because that's the primary aim of his. Once that's broken, everything is this side, that side, people start worshipping the devil. And you keep on going. Even people who look pious, they make mistakes. They make mistakes. They may not know. I mean, you're kicking a jinn out and suddenly he talks to you. You feel pious for a moment. You do. Because why? You're talking to a jinn. And you don't realize in that feeling of great piety, the jinn is lying to you, man. And you've never thought about it. So if someone says, where did you get the name from? Say, but the jinn told me himself. We heard it. We saw it. I saw the dream. I saw the name. I saw the face. I saw the sign. You know, we went to the house. We opened something. We got a whole ball of hair. We went to the other place. We saw frog's legs. And we went right this side here. And they took out two lizard's tails from my belly. That's all jinn. You know, we call it camera tricks, right? But it's the jinn. They play. They know how to play. That is the wrong path. It's the path of doom, my brothers and sisters. It is not the path of the deen. Going back to the messengers of Allah. They struggled in their health. They struggled. I gave you the example of Ayyub alayhi salam. In their wealth, they struggled as well. In so many ways. In their relations with society, they struggled. In their relations with their family members, they went through hardship. Look at Nuh, the Prophet Noah, may peace be upon him. His family rejected the message. His son rejected the message. He kept on calling his son. Allah gave him glad tidings after that. To say what? Oh Nuh, don't worry. Don't worry about what has gone and what's lost. All these people, they were always doomed. They're gone. We will grant you offspring now. Such that all those who come onto the earth after you will only be from your family. Did you ever know that? So after the time of Nuh alayhi salam, the people who were with him, none of them bore children. He was the only one. He was having children. So we are all the children of Noah. Nuh alayhi salam. That's definitely a common forefather. You know, it reminds me of people, you go to them and they say, I'm from the family of the Prophet. So I remember one of the sheikhs, Sheikh Hussein Yi, you know, we were talking to him. He's from China, he's originally Chinese, Malaysian. So he was saying once to us that, you know what? I'm also from the family of the Prophet. Oh, wow. So the people were looking a bit perplexed because, why? You come from China, family of the Prophet. So they just looked at him and, like gulping, you can see they didn't want to believe. He says, the Prophet Noah, by the way, Nuh alayhi salam. You know? That's a fact. That's a guarantee. So we are all from the family of the Prophet, aren't we? We are. Subhanallah. Live up to that. I heard you guys saying yes, but you didn't know that it comes with responsibility. The worst thing you want, someone says, Miss Sayyidun, you heard that. And he's in the nightclub. I mean, relax. What? How is that going to help you? Subhanallah. I've heard it and I've seen it. Guy smoking away, you know, he's no sign of him being anywhere close to the deen. And he's claiming, I'm from the lineage of the Prophet. And his daughter wants to marry the guy who's a 5 times salah in the masjid. He says, no, you can't. He's not a Sayyid, which means he doesn't come to the nightclub with me. May Allah forgive us. That is false. It is baseless. You cannot stop someone from marrying your child just because you have lineage, even if you do have the lineage. Remember that. Wallahi, we are struggling. We are struggling. Because we've deviated from the path. That's what it is. We've allowed culture to overtake us. No more glad tidings coming our way. Everything is bad news, bad news. One after the other. You want glad tidings? There's the path of the messengers. They went through difficulty, but they enjoyed it. Enjoyed it meaning they were content. They were happy. Look at Taif. The glad tidings Allah gave to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What was it? This is something amazing. It's an example I love to give. That year the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam lost his wife, the most blessed person unto him. So much so that he didn't allow anyone to say a negative word about Khadija radiallahu anha after she passed away. He used to miss her. He used to actually send gifts for those who were close to his wife because that was the relationship they had with his wife. Subhanallah. All his children besides Ibrahim were from her. Subhanallah. Amazing. He lost her. 10th year of Hijri. He was quite sad. It's normal, natural to be sad. He lost his uncle, Abu Talib, who helped him so much through the deen, and the uncle refused to accept the deen. So it hurt him, meaning he was saddened. It was known as Amul Huzn. Because of the sadness. So he decided, you know, let me go to Taif. Let's see what happens. You know, everything here is reminding me of my wife and my uncle and so on. And you know, let me go and spread the message. He went out to Taif. What did they do to him? They harmed him. They started throwing stones at him. They literally tried to chase him out and they drove him out of Taif. Subhanallah. He kept on making dua. Do you know what? One of the du'as was where he says, oh Allah, if you are not displeased with me, I don't mind what's happening. Subhanallah. What does that teach me and you? When calamity strikes us, a lot of the times we would think as Muslimin that, you know, maybe this is a punishment. What have I done? That's the first stopping stone. Trust me, it's the first step. So calamity strikes, you ask yourself, what have I done? So you go back into your life and you try and search and you say, Astaghfirullah, even if you can't find anything. Oh Allah, forgive me for that which I know I've done, for that which I do not know I've done. I've displeased you perhaps in some way, forgive me. And you make sincere repentance. So that is a way. It does not mean what happened to you was a punishment. It doesn't mean that. But it just means you're ticking the boxes. Like when you go for a blood test, you might be all clear, but you still went for the test. You see, because you want to make sure that it wasn't what you thought it was. They rule out certain things, okay? The same way, we're ruling out that this is a punishment. We rule that out. By doing what? Istighfar. So we seek Allah's forgiveness. That's the first stage. You have to seek Allah's forgiveness. It's normal to think, as a mu'min, as a believer, that this might just be a punishment. It's normal to think that. But you seek forgiveness and then don't become depressed. Once you sought forgiveness, it's accepted and you move on. You go to the next stage. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, What did he do? He then says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, "Oh Allah, whatever's happened here, for as long as you are happy with me, you are pleased with me, I don't mind. It's okay." Which means it's not a punishment. It's not a punishment, so it's okay. If you are not upset with me, فَلَا أُبَالِي, I don't mind. It's okay. Subhanallah. Then the angels came and told him, "We can crush these people." And he said, "No." He made a dua, "Oh Allah, guide them." Now look at the glad tidings. Something bad is happening to you and you decided to seize the opportunity to pray to Allah, to ask for something good. You will have glad tidings. Why? A moment of difficulty and hardship. People are stressing you. Instead of saying, "Oh Allah, destroy them." You know, earlier today we heard that if there was a 10% chance of your dua to be accepted, would you make dua for destruction of someone or a good dua? A lot of us would actually make dua for the destruction of people whom we actually related to. Yeah. I swear. Imagine if you were at home and you're struggling, something's gone wrong, and so, and here comes an angel saying, "Hey, you have one dua, you know, answer." How many people can I destroy with that one dua? Right? Because they made my life a mess. That's wrong. That's wrong. That's not the sign of a believer. A true believer says, "How many can I guide? Oh Allah, guide all these people. Let them become my best friends. Let them, you know," whatever you want to say. But it must be positive, not negative. Because if you destroy, you'll end up destroying the whole world. There'll only be two people left, you and your wife. And trust me, both of you will be saying, "Oh Allah, destroy him, oh Allah, destroy her." Finish. And then it's just you standing on earth, "Ya Allah, I need heaven," which means now I need to die too. So my brothers and sisters, we need to understand, you want glad tidings, you need to want it for others as well. Did you hear that? I want something good, I need to want it for you. So the Prophet ﷺ says, "Oh Allah, guide them. If you haven't guided these people, guide their offspring." So Allah guided them after Al-Fatih. Allah guided them all. Today go to Taif, subhanallah, subhanallah. You wouldn't believe what happened there if it weren't for imaniyat and our own conviction and belief. I give you another example of the messengers. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They decided to go for Umrah. And guess what happened? They arrived in Mecca. Checkpoint. There was a checkpoint. Have you seen those checkpoints? The kuffar decided, "No ways. Out. You're not coming here." Okay? That's what they decided. Out. But we have no arms, no weapons, meaning we're not coming to fight. We want to come to do our Umrah. No? Not allowed. Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu went in and the discussion started and there was a rumor he was killed and something happened and so on and so forth. But at the end of all of that, the Muslims decided that they will strike this agreement known as Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, which said, very, you know, seemingly unfair, it said there that the Muslims will go back without making the Umrah and they're going to come back the following year. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "No problem." Another clause they added, "No problem." A third clause they added, "No problem." They said, "Remove this Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. We don't believe in Allah. Take it out." And you say Rasulullah. We don't believe you are Rasulullah. Say Muhammad Abdullah, Muhammad ibn Abdullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't believe you are the messenger. And everything he removed. Everything. It's a very emotional narration. Filled with emotion, subhanallah. I tell you what happened after that. As they were leaving, glad tidings came to them of the highest order in this world. The highest order of glad tidings in this world. What that means is regarding the world. You know, glad tidings, the best that you could ever have is of Jannah. Jannah. That's the glad tidings that all the messengers have told us about. But in this case, Surah Al-Fatih was revealed. Surah of the victory. As they are leaving without having made the Umrah, feeling all, you know, sad and feeling bad, here comes Jibreel alayhi salam with verses
إنا فتحنا لك فتحا مبينا.
Indeed, we have granted you a manifest victory. Some of the companions asked, is this actually a victory? Look at what's happened. We've given in to all what they've said. We're walking away. And here Allah is saying victory. That's glad tidings. Allah says, when you endure, things may not happen your way initially. But trust me, when the doors open, they will fling open so wide that everything that you had ever wanted will come in your direction and way beyond what you expected. We learn from this because we're all going through this in our lives. We're blocked from something. We're stopped from something. It happens to every one of us. You want a job? No, you can't have it. Hang on. Bear patience. Thank Allah. Victory will come. Matter of time. Matter of time. Keep on worshipping Allah. Be dedicated towards Allah. And you find the victory will come in your direction. It will definitely come. So, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, yes, indeed, this is a victory. They went back to Medina Munawwara. They sent letters to all the leaders of the neighboring nations. Subhanallah. The deen spread far and wide. And sometime later, the people of Quraysh broke the treaty. By the time they broke the treaty, the Muslims in number were huge. It was swollen in a short period of time. The numbers became large. And they decided, you know what? We're marching on to Makkah. That's what we're doing. We're marching on. A few years later, a little while later. Had it not been for the agreement of Hudaybiyah, they would not have had the chance, the time of peace in order to develop and grow. There was a peace treaty. Had it not been for that peace treaty, they would have been at war. And when there is war, you and I know there is destruction. There is no room for growth because there is war. May Allah grant us peace. Because at times of peace, that's when development happens. That's when growth happens. We learned it from this story. No peace, no growth. So subhanallah, when they were marching onto Makkah, the glad tidings coming into reality, that was the victory. Ultimate victory, the victory of Makkah. The ultimate victory was the victory of Makkah. Subhanallah. Now my brothers and sisters, I want to end by telling you something. Every one of us will have in our own lives something similar to the victory of Makkah. In the difficulties we go through, we have a mirror of all the difficulties the messengers went through. What have you gone through? What are you going through right now? I promise you, there are similar examples in the lives of the messengers. Each one of them were patient. Because of the patience, they were granted victory. And they were given glad tidings. So much so that the Quran says to us that those who are steadfast. Now steadfastness includes a lot. Istiqamah means to stand firm on the path that you are taught. So those who stand firm on the path, they are patient because they are on the path. They try their best to please Allah. They continue in the most beautiful way. Allah says we will give them the ultimate good news. That's beyond the victory of Makkah because now it's connected to the hereafter. What is it? Jannah.
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا رَبُّنَا اللَّهُ ثُمَّ اسْتَقَامُوا تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ أَلَّا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ التي كنتم توعدون.
Allah says, indeed, those who believe and are steadfast. You need these two qualities. You believe and you are steadfast. Once you say you believe, Allah says, we will test you again and again and again and again. And you need to prove that you are steadfast. So sometimes when a person doesn't believe, disbelievers.
They probably will have far less tests than us. Less tests.
When you say you believe, that's when you've now entered the exam room. Now you will have to answer the questions. That's what Allah says in the Quran. You know, the people outside the college, they cannot enter the exam. It's not for them. Once you've entered the college, enrolled, the exam is yours. You will be asked the difficult questions, not the ones outside. With us, we look at sometimes those around us who may be disbelievers. We say, how come they're enjoying? They're not in the exam room, by the way. They're not in the exam room. How come we say, La ilaha illallah, we're having bigger problems? Because you're in the exam room. You've believed in Allah. Allah says, I'm going to test you. You have come into the school. So now, all the tests are going to keep on becoming more and more and more difficult as time passes, because you only get a PhD after you've been through a lot in terms of tests. That's what it is. We don't understand it. Many people become despondent. You know, I believe in Allah. Now I'm being tested. So now I'm weak in my faith again. Because why is Allah testing me? I'm a good believer. I read my salah. Well, that's exactly why Allah is testing you. Because you're in the college. I hope you understand my example here. So Allah says, those who believe, and after they believe, they are steadfast regarding the test that we place in their lives. We choose the questions. You know, you cannot enter an exam room and tell the invigilator, listen, I'm going to write my own questions here. That's not an examination. They have to give you the examination. So what happens? The hadith of the Prophet ﷺ explains what these tests are. But in this verse, it's just in brief. Istiqamah. You are straight. Allah says, before they die, at the point of death, the angels come down. Listen to the good news. Imagine the point of death. The angels come down. And guess what they do? They say, hey, don't worry. You know, we're about to take your soul out of you. Don't worry. تَتَنَزَّلُ عَلَيْهِمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ The angels come down. لَا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا Don't be fearful and don't be sad. Don't worry. أَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ We bear glad tidings for you of paradise that you were promised. When are you told this? Just before your eyes close. Imagine, just before your eyes close. Now, when people die and they're in sakarat, imagine, the sakarat sometimes is just a few seconds and sometimes it takes a bit long, you know, the pangs of death. Imagine the angels have already come to you and told you what's going on. That's why you see people really smiling. Wallahi, I've seen it as well. They're so happy, they just... And they're gone. Because perhaps, the angels may have come down to them and told them, لَا تَخَافُوا وَلَا تَحْزَنُوا وَأَبْشِرُوا بِالْجَنَّةِ الَّتِي كُنْتُمْ تُعَدُونَ May that happen to us too. Ameen. The example of the reciter of the Quran in Indonesia, Ja'far Abdul Rahman, a few days ago on the 24th of April. Have you seen the clip? Subhanallah. We've all seen the clip. And who was he? Before that, he was unknown to us. He's become the hero and the dream of every Muslim. The dream. The man started reading the Quran and he started reading Suratul Mulk out of all surahs. And the verse he was reading was the purpose of creation. Allah says, we created death and life in order to test you. These were the words he was reading, the Quran. We created death and life in order to test you. Who from amongst you has better deeds? And indeed, he is, this is the verse of the Quran, right? I'm translating it. This is what he was reading. وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ Indeed, he is most powerful, most forgiving. You go back and watch that clip. You will notice something. When he says, look at the man, from the beginning of the long clip, that's on YouTube, there's a very long clip, right? You look at the man, and what you will notice is, he looks down. While they were introducing him, he looks down. He doesn't look up at all, not at all. I looked very carefully. Why I look carefully is, I was trying to see, go back, these are the last moments of this man. How did he live then? So I noticed he looked down, he did not look up once. They were introducing him, they spoke about him, they said he's going to read. He started the recitation, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan rajim, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. He was looking down, he did not open his eyes once. The only time his eyes rolled was when he said, Al-Ghafoor. Go and check it. وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ. He says, indeed, he is most powerful, most forgiving. And he did this. He actually blinked, looking up. That was it. According to me, that was the point of whatever attacked him. That was the point. After that, imagine if I suffered an attack, you suffered a heart attack or anything. I think we would probably, guys, help me, you know? No. He decided to carry on. Carry on. Push. Until he could do it no more. So he kept on. He said, Alladhi khalaqa sab'a samawatin. And as he said, tibaqan, his head dropped. Allahu Akbar. His last words, go and search. Ja'far Abdul Rahman, rahmatullahi alayhi. We don't know the man before this. But today, we're talking about him. We're inspired. Why? Glad tidings. How you live your life, that's how you will die. And how you die, that's how you will be resurrected. So if you want to have a good death, start doing good things. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. أقول قولي هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد سبحان الله وبحمده سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك.